Hey, good day. Michael Didier here. I'm glad you're there. Thank you for joining us. Going through Yasher still. Boy, I'll tell you, there's a lot in Yasher that we miss out on. A lot of background information for Genesis that we just have no clue as to what's going on. But when we see what Yasher has to say, it makes what we read in Genesis makes so much more sense. Well, let's do a quick review. I'm going to try and keep this quick as I can. Last week, we left off with, remember the sons of Israel went down to Egypt to buy grain. Joseph caught them, called them spies, really wasn't too nice to them. Put them in jail for 3 days, realized, well, that's not gonna work. They're not gonna be able to get food to their families. So they kept Simeon. Remember what happened to Simeon? He did not go peacefully, did he? He screamed, a big scream, and all those 70 men of Joseph ran away. It was little Manasseh, 5 years old. Bunked him in the back of the head, back of the neck. Subdued him and brought him into the jail. Well, you know what? They saw the jail. They were there for 3 days. Then they finally went home. They thought Simeon was in the same place. We found out last week that wasn't the case, didn't we? They got home, realized they had the gold in their sacks. They wanted to go back right then. They wanted to bring Ben back to get Simeon. Jacob would have no part of that, would he? Do you remember what he did? He said, no, we're not going back. Well, soon, a year and 2 months, the corn was finished. The infants of Jacob's seed were crying to Jacob, feed us, we're hungry, we're pinched with hunger. Listen to what Jacob says. And Jacob said unto them, and have you not seen how your sons, really your children, probably Toph in this case, have been weeping over me this day, saying, give us bread, and there is none? Now, he's finally going to make the change. All right, you can take my son. Even that didn't come easy. He argued about it. Do you remember? Remember them talking about Joseph saying, dost thou not know, hast thou not heard that the king is very powerful and wise, that there is none on earth like him? A king of Egypt is greater and mightier than even Avimelech, who they consider one of the best kings there is. Oh, and his wisdom and his understanding and his knowledge, which Elohim has given in his heart, nor heard the sweet voice when he spake unto us. They know there's something different about this man, but they can't put it together. Finally, Jacob says, okay, I'm going to trust Elohim. He's going to be the El who provides, the mighty one who provides. We saw that down here in verse 23. But Judah was going to make himself surety for this young man, Ben, that he's bringing down, Benjamin. Well, he says, bring him down, but I want you to do some things. I want you to bring down gifts. I want you to bring down the double portion. We're going to buy food, and I want you to bring money for the last food. He prayed. His wives, their sons, their children prayed for them. Finally, Jacob writes a note to Joseph, reminding him of who he is. Do you remember? Don't mess with us. I had a chance to pray against you and I didn't. but I still could. Don't let anything happen to my son. He exaggerated a bit. He talked about the 9 kings of Elam instead of the 4 kings of Elam. Talked about Simeon and Levi, 2 sons, taking out those 8 cities. They took out 1 city. They helped the brothers take out, the brothers and the servants, take out the other 7. Well, we finally get to Egypt. And remember, Joseph beholds his brother. He wants to cry. Oh my gosh, he's here, he's alive. I think that was one of the things that Joseph wanted to find out. Is Ben safe? We found out that Simeon was in the house of the Egyptians, the house of the Lord of the Egyptians, the Adon of the Egyptians, and was treated kindly. How did he stay with Joseph? Maybe he wasn't seeing Joseph on a daily basis. Big house. But I would think, how could he be with Joseph and not finally recognize who Joseph is? Maybe it was the language barrier. When Joseph saw his brother, again, he wanted to weep. Do you remember what he did? He used his cup. Remember the cup that they said they used for divination? We'll see it again today. He used this for divination, it says. And he says, by this cup, I know that you are the sons of one mother. And so then he named the boys. Put them in their birth order. Reuben, Simeon, Levi, Judah, Issachar, Zebulun. I guess that's 6. It says in Torah that he set them all aside. I always thought Ben was sitting aside with his brothers. But in Yasher, it has Ben being pulled aside. Remember, he says, I know that this man is an only son. I'm going to have him sit with me. And when he was sitting with him, do you remember what happened? He revealed himself to Benjamin. First they talked, do you have any sons? Yeah, he's got 10 sons, 2 wives. Then he said, here's an instrument. Look at that, verse 20. And Benjamin beheld the instrument with the map of the stars of heaven. And he was wise and looked therein to know where his brother was. And Benjamin divided the whole earth of the land of Egypt into 4 divisions. You know, I always have to wonder, is this something, you know, this? I don't think this is divination that we're talking about. Maybe it's a skill that both Benjamin and Joseph were taught by Jacob. Something that's been passed down. Maybe it's an instrument that Pharaoh had, Joseph had. Maybe he had it made for him. Who knows? But if they could find Joseph, remember, he used it. He said, I perceive by this that my brother's sitting right next to me on the throne. And this is where we left off last week. He says, and Benjamin said to Joseph, I see that Joseph, my brother, sitteth here with me upon the throne. And Joseph said unto him, I am Joseph, thy brother. Reveal it not to thy brethren. Or behold, I will send thee with them when they go away. And I will command them to be brought again into the city, and I will take thee away from them. Kind of giving him the heads up. And if they dare their lives and fight for thee, then I shall know that they have repented of what they did unto me. Well, this is where we left off last week. We're going to turn to Genesis first, and then we'll come back to this, okay? Let's do that. That took me 11 minutes. That was really good. All right. Here's, did I say 43 or 44? I think I said 44. I put one last test. Ooh, this is a doozy of a test too. My goodness, wait till you see. And he commanded the steward of his house, saying, "Fill the men's sacks with food, as much as they can carry, and put each man's money in the mouth of the sack. Also put my cup." Remember, we're talking about the cup that he showed off with, saying that I know by this cup that you are the eldest and you are the youngest. Put them all in their birth orders. And also put my cup, the silver cup, in the mouth of the sack of the youngest, and his grain money with it. So he did according to the word that Joseph had spoken. As soon as the morning dawned, the men were sent away, they and their donkeys. And when they had gone out of the city and were not yet far off, Joseph said to his steward, "Get up, follow the men. And when you overtake them, say to them, 'Why have you repaid evil for good?'" Here it is. This is what I was telling you about. Is not this the one which my Lord drinks, and with which he indeed practices divination? This is when he finds the cup, what he's supposed to tell him. "You have done evil in so doing." Well, you know, here it says that Joseph is practicing divination. Is he practicing divination? You know, there's a lot of things that we see in Torah that we take at face value, but we don't realize that they're lying. He's lying. He told his servant to lie. He doesn't practice divination. A lot of people will make doctrines based on this because they take everything for literal truth. But we've got to understand the deeper picture here. He says, "You have done evil." I put, the steward faithfully carries out Zaphanat's Paaniah's orders and takes the unsuspecting and overtakes the unsuspecting brothers. The brothers are accused not merely of being thieves, but also of repaying evil for good. Oh, may it never be. What does Yahovah have to say about evil for good? Look at this. Is 1 Samuel 25:21. Now David had said, "Surely in vain I have kept all that this fellow has in the wilderness, so that nothing was missed of all that pertaineth unto him." He's talking about Nabal. He's kept his animals safe. He's not missed anything. "And he has requited me evil for good." You don't do that. "They rewarded me evil for good to the bereavement of my soul." Here's Psalms 109. "And they have rewarded me evil for good, and hated and hatred for my love." "Whoso rewardeth evil for good, evil shall not depart from his house." Don't reward evil or for good. Not a good idea. So he overtook them and he spoke to them these same words. And they said unto him, "Why does Adonai say these words? It says, 'Far from us.'" I wanted to look at this and see what it actually says. I put, "May it never be." This is one word. "May it never be." It doesn't say us. There's no us in this. But he's just saying, "May it never be that your servants should do such a thing." We're going to see this again in 14. No, 17. We'll get back to it. Verse 8. Look, we brought back to you from the land of Canaan the money which we found in the mouth of our sacks. This is how honest we are. We're not trying to steal anything. We're not trying to be unkind. We're not trying to be wicked. We're being as faithful as we can. He says, how then can we steal silver and gold from your Adon's house? Now, they're so convinced that they're innocent. Look what they do. They do a, really taking an oath. With whoever of your servants it is found, let him die. And we will also be my lord's, Adonai's, slaves. Avdim. Ooh, rash words. Guard your words. Guard your lips. Here it says, we cannot let rash words out of our mouth. We must guard our lips. Here's some verses for you. I think they're important. I said, I will guard my ways, lest I sin with my tongue. Did you know you can sin with your tongue? I will restrain my mouth with a muzzle, while the wicked are before me. Set a guard, O Yehovah, over my mouth. Keep watch over the door of my lips. Remember, he said, this people honors me with their mouth, draws nigh unto me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching the traditions of men, and forget my commandments. Set a guard, O Yehovah, over my mouth. Keep watch over the door of my lips. Do not trust in a friend. Do not put your confidence in a companion. Guard the door of your mouth from her who lies in your bosom. Do not be rash with your mouth. This is Ecclesiastes, a couple of Ecclesiastes. Do not be rash with your mouth, and let not your heart utter anything hastily before Elohim. This is what they're doing. Uttering something hastily before Yehovah. Oh my goodness, it gets us in trouble. For Elohim is in heaven, and you are on earth. Therefore, let your words be few. You know what? We speak too many words. Words in anger, words in pride, words in hurt. Guard your words. Here's Solomon again. The words of a wise man's mouth are gracious, but the lips of a fool shall swallow him up. The words of his mouth begin with foolishness, and the end of his talk is raving madness. Wow, raving madness. You want to go crazy? Well, here's some examples. Well, these words are uttered in desperation, in full confidence and belief of their innocence. That's these words right now. With whomever your servant has found, let him die. And we also will be my Adonai's slaves. They believe they're innocent. Little did the brothers understand the danger that they put themselves in. Again and again, Yehovah warns us against such hasty statements. We have already witnessed one such story in Genesis. Do you remember the one with Rachel? In which Jacob unknowingly condemned his beloved woman Rachel by his oath to Laban. Here's what he said. With whoever thou findest thy Elohim. Remember, Rachel had stolen the Elohim. hidden him under the saddle. Let him not live. Before our brethren, discern thou which is thine with me, and take it to thee. For Jacob knew not that Rachel had stolen them. I wonder if that's why Rachel died so early. I used to think that was the case. But you know, who was it? Her sister, Leah. She only died 5 years later. They both died fairly young. Jephthah, remember him? Likewise cursed his own daughter by his words of an oath uttered without thought. Look what he said. What was he thinking? And Jephthah vowed a vow unto Jehovah and said, if thou shalt without fail deliver Ammon's seed into my hands, then it shall be that whatever comes forth of the door of my house to meet me when I return in peace from Ammon's seed shall surely be Jehovah's, and I will offer it up for a burnt offering. So Jephthah passed over unto Ammon's seed to fight against them, and Jehovah delivered them into his hands. And he smote from Aroer even till thou come to Minnith, even 20 cities, and unto the plains of the vineyards with a very great slaughter. Thus Ammon's seed were subdued before Israel's seed, and Jephthah came to Mizpeh unto his house, and behold, his daughter came out to meet him with timbrels and with dance. And she was his only child. Besides her, he had neither son nor daughter. Remember, she ended up dying. He was going to honor his vow. Wow, that sure doesn't jive with us, does it? Again, guard the words of your mouth. Well, let's continue. And he said, now also let it be according to your words. This is the steward of Joseph's house saying this. Remember, they had just said, let him die. We will be his slaves. But now he says, let it be according to your words. But he doesn't have the same words. He says, he with whom it was found shall be my slave, and you shall be blameless. Wow. I think he was trying to prevent the death of someone, Benjamin in this case, and the others being slaves. The goal is not to make them slaves. The goal is to get to the truth, isn't it? It says, then each man speedily let down his sack to the ground, and each opened his sack. So he searched, and he began with the oldest and left off with the youngest. And the cup was found in Benjamin's sack. Then they tore their clothes, and each man loaded his donkey and returned to the city. And Judah and his brothers came to Joseph's house, and he was still there, and they fell before him to the ground. And Joseph said to them, what deed is this that you have done? Did you not know that such a man as I can certainly practice divination? Okay, is he telling the truth or is he lying? This is a lie. It's a test. Then Judah said, what shall we say to Adonai? What shall we speak? Or how shall we clear ourselves? You know what? In Yasher, they know something's wrong. They're being tricked. But how do you say that to the ruler who you got to get food from? God has found out our iniquity, or found out the iniquity of your servants. Here we are, Adonai's slaves. both we and he also with whom the cup was found. Here's that same word. But he said, that's the word I like, may it never be that I should do so. The man in whose hand the cup was found, he shall be thy my slave. And as for you, go up in peace to your father. Your brother's got his day. Remember, he said he was going to take him. We saw that in Yasher. It's part of the test. He knows it. Benjamin knows it. Then Judah came near to him and said, oh, Adonai, please let your servant speak a word in Adonai's ear. And do not let your anger burn against your servants, for you are even like Pharaoh. Oh, they have respect for Joseph, don't they? They realize that he's got power. But Joseph doesn't know. Well, Joseph does know. They just don't know that Joseph knows what power they have. Look what he says. Adonai asked his servant, saying, have you a father or a brother? He's recalling what happened. And we said to Adonai, we have a father, an old man, and a son, I'm guessing a son. Let's see if I had that. Oh, it doesn't say it at all. Child, well, maybe it does say it. And he alone is left with his mother, and his father loves him. What did I have here? And we said to Adonai, we have a father, an old man, and a child of his old age, who is young. His brother's dead, and he alone is left of his mother's sons. Look what it actually says. It doesn't say sons at all. This word right here doesn't exist in Torah. It says this. He alone is left of his mother. He alone is left of his mother. Ooh, that puts a whole new spin on it, doesn't it? Because this is talking about mother's sons, and this is talking about Rachel. He loved Rachel. This is part of what they call Rachel's seed. Does he, when he look at Ben, see Rachel in him? Did he see Rachel in Benjamin? Or it's in Joseph? Oh, that really changed things for me. And his father loves him. Why? He alone is left of his mother. Wow. Then you said to your avadim, your servants, bring him down to me that I may set my eyes on him. And we said to Adonai, the lad cannot leave his father, for if he should leave his father would die. Well, that was maybe a little bit of an exaggeration because he didn't die. But you said to your avadim, your servants, unless your youngest brother comes down with us, you shall not see my face no more. You shall see my face no more. So it was when we went up to your servants, comma, my father, to your servants, my father. Remember, this is Judah talking. Why is Judah talking? He's the one that's surety for his brother. When we went up to your servant, my father, we told him the words of Adonai. And our father said, go back and buy a little food. Yeah, after a year and 2 months, wasn't going to have any part of it then, would he? But we said, we cannot go down. If our youngest brother is with us, then we can go down. for we may not see the man's face unless our youngest brother is with us. Then your servant, my father, said to us, you know that my woman bore me two sons. Did you hear that? Who's it about, the sons or the woman? Makes a little bit more sense now, doesn't it? I like that. You know that my woman bore me two sons, and the one went out from me, and I said, surely he is torn to pieces, and I have not seen him since. But if you take this one also from me, and calamity befalls him, you shall bring down my gray hair with sorrow to the grave. Now therefore, when I come to your servant, my father, and the lad is not with us, since his life is bound up with the lad's life, it will happen when he sees the lad is not with us, that he will die. So your servants will bring down the gray hair of your servant, our father, with sorrow to the grave. For your servant became surety for the lad. Who's he talking about? He's talking about himself. For your servant, this is Judah, became surety for the lad to my father, saying, if I do not bring him back, then I shall bear the blame before my father forever. Well, he's going to bear the blame before Pharaoh forever too. We're going to see today that when Joseph wants to keep Benjamin, that Judah is going to volunteer to be surety for him. Take his place. He says, I'll be your servant. Ooh, it's really interesting to see how it pans out. We'll get there hopefully today. Now, therefore, please let your servant remain instead of the lad as a slave to Adonai, and let the lad go up with his brothers. You know what? I'm going to put this at the top of the page, you guys. Let me do this. All right. Now, therefore, please let your servant remain instead of the lad. This is what surety is all about. As a slave, an aved to Adonai, and let the lad go up with his brothers. This is what surety is all about. Judah's going to take the blame for his brother's supposed actions. You take the blame for the laws that your human, that you signed for on your driver's license. Remember, we talked about that last week. You are surety for that man. You wouldn't be under those laws except for your signature on that driver's license. That's why you got to be represented in court. That's why you got to represent yourself in court. Because you're not yourself, you're surety for yourself. But we don't know it. For how shall I go up to my father if the lad is not with me? Lest perhaps I see the evil that would come upon my father. I like what BBE said. This is Bible in Basic English. For how may I go back to my father without the boy, and see the evil which will come upon my father? Well, there's a test coming, isn't there? We saw it. Now we get to read it in Yasher. At that time, Joseph commanded his officers to fill their sacks with food. We're backtracking now. And to each, here, remember where we left off? He had just told Benjamin that he was going to test his brothers. Remember? At that time, Joseph commanded his officers to fill their sacks with food, and to put each man's money in his sack, and to put the cup in the sack of Benjamin, and to give them provision for the road. And they did so unto them. And on the next day the men rose up early in the morning, and they loaded their asses with corn, and they went forth with Benjamin, and they went to the land of Canaan with their brother Benjamin. You know, you would think almost they had money in their sack the first time. Wouldn't you almost think to check the sacks to find out if there's maybe something that's not supposed to be there? I think I might have. They're very trusting. They had not gone far from Egypt when Joseph commanded him that was set over his house, saying, "Rise, pursue these men before they get too far from Egypt, and say unto them, why have you stolen my master's cup, Adonai's cup?" And Joseph's officers rose up, and he reached them, and he spoke unto them the words of Joseph. And when they heard this thing, they became exceedingly wroth. Remember what happens when they get exceedingly wroth. They get dangerous, don't they? And they said, "He with whom my master's cup shall be found shall die, and we shall become slaves." Wow. And they hastened, and each man brought down his sack from his ass. And they looked in their bags, and the cup was found in Benjamin's bag. And they all tore their garments, and they returned to the city. Look at what's going on while they're returning to the city. Remember, Benjamin knows what's going on. It says, and they smote Benjamin on the road, continually smiting him until he came into the city, and they stood before Joseph. Well, they're not quite before Joseph. And Judah's anger was kindled. And he said, "This man has only brought me back to destroy Egypt this day." Hear that? The men are exceedingly wroth. "This man has only brought me back to Egypt to destroy it." This is the attitude that's going on. We don't see it in Torah, do we? But this is what's going on. Wait till you see what happens. This is one of my favorite parts of Yasher. And the men came to Joseph's house, and they found Joseph sitting upon his throne, and all the mighty men standing at his right and his left. And Joseph said unto them, "What is this act which you have done, that you took away my silver cup and went away? But I know that you took my cup in order to know thereby in which part of the land your brother was. You want to use it for divination." And Judah said, "What shall we say, Adon, our Adon? What shall we speak? And how shall we justify ourselves? Elohim has this day found the iniquity of all thy servants. Therefore, he has done this thing to us this day." Well, obviously, Joseph knows and understands exactly what they're saying. They think he doesn't. And Joseph rose up and caught hold of Benjamin and took him from his brethren with violence. Oh my goodness. And he came to the house and locked the door at them. And Joseph commanded him that was set over his house that he should say unto them, "Thus says the king." What happened? He took his brother, went into the house, and shut the door. Now the servant, the overseer of the house, is coming out. "Go in peace to your father. Behold, I have taken the man in whose hand my cup was found." Talk about exceedingly wroth. He's already talking about Judah's already talking about destroying Egypt. Now look what's going to happen. You don't see this in Dora. We saw him take the boy, but we don't hear about the door being knocked down. Look what it says. Oh, here, what does my notes say? Yeah, Judah's the one who's surety for the boy. And when Judah saw the dealings of Joseph with them, Judah approached him and broke open the door and came with his brethren before Joseph. Ooh, can you imagine? Let's look at the White House. We got the White House, and the president has done something, and now these men are saying, no, bash down the door of the Oval Room. Can you imagine? This is what's going on. Wow. And Judah said unto Joseph, let it not seem grievous in your sight. Adonai, they're still being respectful. May thy servant, I pray thee, speak a word before thee. And Joseph said unto him, speak. And Judah spoke before Joseph, and his brethren were there standing before them. And Judah said unto Joseph, surely we first came to Aradon to buy food. Okay, remember, this is where we saw in the last chapter. He's kind of relating to them what happened. Do you have a brother? Do you have a father? Is this school? You got to bring your brother up here. This is what's going on. I'm going to go back. And Judah spoke before Joseph, and his brethren were there standing before them. Okay, he's telling you this because these are all powerful men. And Judah said unto Joseph, surely we first came to our Lord to buy food. Thou didst consider us as spies of the land, and we brought Benjamin before thee, and thou makest sport of us this day. See, he knows something's going on. Now, therefore, let the king hear my words. Yeah, you've been talking all this time. Now let me say something. And send, I pray thee, our brother, that we may go along with us, that he may go along with us to our father, lest thy soul perish this day with all the souls of the inhabitants of Egypt. Remember, these men took out seven cities of the Amorites, huge cities. They're already in the city. They don't even have to break in. They're already there. Dost thou not know what two of my brethren, Simeon and Levi, did unto the city of Shechem and unto the seven cities of the Amorites on account of our sister Dinah, and also what they will do for the sake of their brother Benjamin? And I, with my strength, who am greater and mightier than both of them, will come this day upon thee and thy land, if thou art unwilling to send our brother. Hast thou not heard what Elohim, who made choice of us, did unto Pharaoh on account of Sarah, our mother, grandmother, whom he took away from our father, that he smote him and his household with the heavy plagues, that even to this day the Egyptians relate this wonder to each other? So our Elohim do unto thee on account of Benjamin, whom thou hast this day taken from his father, on account of the evil which thou this day heapest over us in thy land. The evil which thou heapest over us. He knows what's going on. For our Elohim will remember his covenant with our father Abraham and bring evil upon thee, because thou hast grieved the soul of our father this day. Now therefore, hear my words, that I may have this day spoken unto thee, and send our brother that he may go away, lest thou and the people of thy land die by the sword. For you cannot all prevail over me. Well, now we're going to have kind of a bantering going back between Joseph and Judah. And Joseph answered Judah, saying, why hast thou opened wide thy mouth? And why dost thou boast over us, saying, strength is with thee? As Pharaoh liveth, if I command all my valiant men to fight with you, surely thou and these brethren would sink in the mire. And Judah said unto Joseph, surely it becometh thee and thy people to fear me. As Jehovah liveth, if I once draw my sword, I shall not sheathe it again until this day have slain all Egypt. And I will commence with thee and finish with Pharaoh thy master. Oh, man. Bold words. And Joseph answered and said unto him, surely strength belongeth not alone to thee. I am stronger and mightier than thou. Surely if thou drawest thy sword, I will put it to thy neck. If thou draws your sword, this is Joseph, you draw your sword, I'm going to put it to your neck and the necks of all your brethren. And Judah said unto him, surely if I this day open my mouth against thee, I would swallow thee up, that thou may be destroyed from off the earth, and perish this day from thy kingdom. And Joseph said, surely if thou open thy mouth, I have power and might to close thy mouth with a stone, until thou shalt not be able to utter a word. See how many stones are before us? Truly I will take a stone and force it in thy mouth and break thy jaw. Well, he's talking to a mighty man. Look what Judah does. And Judah said, Elohim is witness between us that we have not hitherto desired to battle with thee. We didn't come to fight. Haven't thought about it. Only give us our brother and we will go from thee. And Joseph answered and said, as Pharaoh liveth, if all the kings of Canaan came together with you, you should not take him from my hand. Remember, this is a test. Will they fight for their brother? Sure looks like it to me. Now therefore, go your way to your father and your brothers. Your brother shall be unto me for a slave, for he has robbed the king's house. And Judah said, what is it to thee, or to the character of the king? Sure, the king sendeth forth from his house throughout the land silver and gold, either in gifts or expenses. And thou still talking about thy cup, a stinking cup? Which thou did place in our brother's bag, and saith that he has stolen it from thee? Oh, he knows something's going on. Elohim forbid that our brother Benjamin or any seed of Abraham should do such a thing, to steal from thee or from anyone else, whether king, prince, or any man. We're honest men. We don't steal. Now therefore, cease this accusation, lest the whole earth hear thy words, saying, for a little silver the king of Egypt wrangled with the men, and he accused them and took their brother for a slave. And Joseph answered and said, take unto you this cup. Take the cup. And go from me, leave your brother for a slave. For it is the judgment of a thief to be a slave. Take the cup. And Judah said, why art thou not ashamed of thy words to leave our brother and take the cup? Yeah, right. Surely if thou givest us thy cup, or 1,000 times as much, we will not leave our brother for the silver which is found in the hand of any man, that we will not die over him. Oh, man. And Joseph answered, why did you forsake your brother and sell him for 20 pieces of silver unto this day? Hear that? We're talking boldness now. He's got inside information. Jews should be saying, how did he know that? And why did thou forsake your brother and sell for 20 pieces of silver unto this day? And why then will you not do the same to this your brother? Well, he's going to ignore the question, Judah. Look what he says. Yehovah is witness between me and thee that we desire not thy battles. Now therefore give us our brother and we will go from thee without quarreling. And Joseph answered and said, if all the kings of the land should assemble, they will not be able to take your brother from my hand. And Judah said, what shall we say unto our father when he seeth that our brother cometh not with us and will grieve over him? Remember, Joseph has already received the message that Jacob wrote prior to them coming with Benjamin. Remember what he said? Related to him all the things that will happen. Joseph or Jacob didn't pray for him to be destroyed, but he could. What shall we say unto our father when he seeth that our brother cometh not with us and will grieve over him? Then Joseph answered and said, this is the thing which you shall tell unto your father, saying, look at this, the rope has gone after the bucket. The rope has gone after the bucket. Who's the bucket? Joseph went down into a well. Is it possible that Benjamin is the rope? Is he relating back to the same situation with him being sold? That was his last comment. And we have this comment. Look at what his next comment's going to be. First, we got to hear what Judas says. Surely, he's going to ignore it again. Surely, thou art a king. And why speaketh thou these things, giving false judgments? Woe unto the king who is like unto thee. You're not judging with equity, king. It's going to get you in trouble. But it's a test. Now, look at this. He goes back. And Joseph answered and said, there is no false judgment in the words that I spoke on account of your brother Joseph. For all of you sold him to the Midianites for 20 pieces of silver. How do they know that? And you all denied it to your father and said unto him, an evil beast has devoured him. Joseph has been torn in pieces. Hear that? Judah keeps ignoring these questions, doesn't he? And Judah said, behold, the fire of Shem burneth in my heart. How strange this is. The fire of Shem burneth in my heart. Now I will burn all your land with fire. And Joseph answered and said, surely thy, they said, sister-in-law. She is not a sister-in-law. She would be a daughter-in-law, wouldn't she? Your daughter-in-law, Tamar, who killed your sons, extinguished the fire of Shechem. Shechem, what does Shechem have to do with anything? We're just talking about the fire of Shem. I think we got a bad translation here. I think this should say Shem. Why would he say that? What did Joseph do? I'm sorry, what did Judah do in taking Tamar? Do you remember? She was a betrothed woman, wasn't she? Betrothed to who? Shelah. But he took, on the road, thinking she was a harlot, took her to himself and ended up taking a betrothed woman. Ooh, not a good thing. A death sentence. Is it possible that what he's saying then is because of the sin that Judah did? That the fire of Shem has been extinguished in him? In other words, I'm not afraid of you! I think that's maybe what's going on. And Judah said, he's going to ignore it again. If I pluck out a single hair of my flesh, I will fill all Egypt with its blood. I don't even understand what he's saying there. And Joseph answered and said, such is your custom to do as you did to your brother whom you sold. And you dipped his coat in the blood and brought it to your father in order that he might say, they didn't say it, they did it, set up the evidence so that he might say it, an evil beast has devoured him and here is his blood. Do you see how Joseph keeps going back to the root of the problem? And when Judah heard this thing, he was exceedingly wroth. Oh my goodness. Yeah, the truth hurts is what I put. Yeah, the truth hurts, doesn't it? But he's getting mad because Joseph keeps going back to the root of the problem. And when Judah heard this thing, he was exceedingly wroth, and his anger burned within him. And there was before him in that place a stone, the weight of which was 400 shekels. I don't know how heavy 400 shekels is. And Judah's anger was kindled, and he took the stone in one hand, cast it to the heavens, caught it with his other hand. And he placed it afterwards under his legs, and he sat upon it with all his strength, and the stone was turned into dust from the fourth force of Judah. Wow, powerful man. Well, now look what happens. And Joseph saw the act of Judah, and he was very much afraid. But he commanded Manasseh his son, and he also did with another stone like unto the act of Judah. And Judah said unto his brethren, look at this. This is the same thing that Simeon said. Let not any man say, this man is an Egyptian. But by his doing this thing, he is of our father's family. How does that work? Well, he says it, but it doesn't really register, does it? And Joseph said, not to you only is strength given, for we are also powerful men. And why will you boast over us all? And Judah said unto Joseph, send, I pray thee, our brother, and ruin not thy land this day. And Joseph answered and said unto them, go and tell your father, an evil beast has devoured him, as you said concerning your brother Joseph. You see how every time he goes back, doesn't he? Well, now look what's going to happen. And Judah spoke to his brother Naphtali, and he said unto him, make haste, go now and number the streets of Egypt, and come and tell me. And Simeon said unto him, let not this thing be a trouble to thee. Now I will go and mount and take up one large stone. This is Simeon. Simeon's saying this now. I will take one large stone from the mount and level it at everyone in Egypt and kill all that are in it. Do you see what's going on? And Joseph heard all these words that his brothers spoke before him. And they did not know that Joseph understood them, for they imagined that he knew not to speak Hebrew. And Joseph was greatly afraid of the words of his brethren, lest they should destroy Egypt. Yeah, he knows what they're capable of. And he commanded his son Manasseh, saying, go, make haste, and gather unto me all the inhabitants of Egypt, and all the valiant men, and let them come to me now upon horseback and on foot, with all sorts of musical instruments. Musical instruments. And Manasseh went and did so. And Naphtali went as Judah had commanded him. Listen to this. For Naphtali was light-footed as one of the swift stags, and he would go upon the ears of the corn, and they would not break under him. Wow, that's like walking on water, isn't it? Booking. And he went and numbered all the streets of Egypt, and found them to be 12. We got 9 men, don't we? 12 streets. And he came hastily and told Judah. And Judah said unto his brethren, hasten you and put on every man his sword upon his loins, and we will come over Egypt and smite them all, and let not a remnant remain. Don't let anyone remain. We're going to kill everybody. And Judah said, behold, I will destroy 3 of the streets with my strength, and you shall each destroy 1 street. He's going to take the extra 2 streets. So 10 sons, 12 streets, means he's got to take 3 streets. And when Judah was speaking these words, behold, the inhabitants of Egypt and all the mighty men came towards them with all sorts of musical instruments and with a loud shouting. And their number was 500 cavalry, 10,000 infantry, and 400 men who could fight without sword or spear, only with their hands. And all the mighty men came with a great storming and shouting, and they all surrounded Jacob's seed and terrified them, and the ground quaked at the sound of their shouting. Okay, it's quaking. They got 10,000 men plus. And when Jacob's seed saw these troops, they were greatly afraid of their lives. And Joseph did so in order to terrify Jacob's seed to become tranquilized. And Judah, seeing some of his brethren terrified, said unto them, why are you afraid? Whilst the grace of Elohim is with us. And when Judah saw all the people of Egypt surrounding them at the command of Joseph to terrify them, only Joseph commanded them, saying, do not touch any of them. And Judah hastened and drew his sword. Remember what he said, if I'd have to draw my sword. And Judah hastened and drew his sword and uttered a loud and bitter scream. Hear that? That's the yell that Jacob's seed has. And he smote with his sword, and he sprang upon the ground, and he still continued to shout against all the people. And when he did this thing, Jehovah caused the terror of Judah and his brethren to fall upon the valiant men and all the people that surrounded them. And they all fled at the sound of the shouting. And they were terrified and fell one upon another. And many of them died as they fell. And they all fled from before Judah and his brethren and from before Joseph. And whilst they were fleeing, Judah and his brethren pursued them unto the house of Pharaoh. And they all escaped. And Judah again sat before Joseph and roared at him like a lion and gave a great and tremendous shriek. Look at this. This is Isaiah 5. He will lift up a banner to the nations from afar, and will whistle to them from the ends of the earth. Surely they shall come with speed, swiftly, just like Naphtali did. No one shall be weary or stumble among them. Remember, they that wait upon Jehovah shall renew their strength. No one will slumber or sleep, nor will the belt of their loins be loosed, nor the strap of their sandals be broken, whose arrows are sharp, and all their bows bent. Their horses' hooves will seem like flint, and their wheels like the whirlwind. Their roaring will be like a lion. They will roar like young lions. Yes, they will roar and lay hold of the prey. They will carry it away swiftly, and no one will deliver. In that day they will roar against them like the roaring of the sea. And if one looks to the land, behold, darkness and sorrow, and the light is darkened by the clouds. That's Jehovah's presence with them. He always comes with the clouds. And the shriek was heard at a distance, and all the inhabitants of Sukkot heard it, and all Egypt quaked at the sound of the shriek, and also the walls of Egypt and the land of Goshen fell in from the shaking of the earth. And Pharaoh also fell from his throne upon the ground, and all the pregnant women of Egypt and Goshen miscarried when they heard the noise of the shaking, for they were terribly afraid. People are dying from Joseph's test. The men who ran away fell over each other, died. And now here's pregnant women dying. Not them, they're miscarrying. And Pharaoh sent word saying, what is this thing that has this day happened to the land of Egypt? He just fell off his throne. Remember, he's 70 steps high. And they came and told him all the things from beginning to end. And Pharaoh was alarmed, and he wondered and was greatly afraid. Do you see the drama going on here? And his fright increased when he heard all these things. And he sent unto Joseph, saying, thou hast brought unto me the Hebrews to destroy all Egypt. What wilt thou do with the thievish slave? Send him away. Let him go with his brethren. Remember, he got the story. He knows what's going on. He knows the words that have been going back and forth. Let us not perish through their evil, even we, you, and all Egypt. But if thou desirest not this thing, cast off from thee all my valuable things. Go with them to their land, if thou delightest in it. For they will this day destroy my whole country and slay all my people. Even all the women of Egypt have miscarried through their screams. See what they have done merely by shouting and speaking. Moreover, if they fight with the sword, they shall destroy the land. Now therefore choose that which thou desirest, whether me or the Hebrews, whether Egypt or the land of the Hebrews. And they came and told Joseph all the words of Pharaoh that he had said concerning him. And Joseph was greatly afraid of the words of Pharaoh, and Judah and his brethren were still standing before Joseph, indignant and enraged. And all Jacob's seed roared at Joseph like the roaring of the sea and its waves. There's the roaring of the sea. They're all yelling, all of them. And Joseph was greatly afraid of his brethren and on account of Pharaoh. And Joseph sought a pretext to make himself known to his brethren, lest they should destroy all Egypt. Okay, they passed the test. They're willing to take out all of Egypt to protect their brethren. But he's still not done. And Joseph commanded his son Manasseh. And Manasseh went and approached Judah and placed his hand on his shoulder. And the anger of Judah stilled. Oh, look at this. And Judah said unto his brethren, let no one say that this is the act of an Egyptian youth. For this is the work of my father's house. This is the third time that this has happened. Remember, we're talking about someone who is no more than 6 years old, this young man. Isn't it interesting that it's always Manasseh and not Ephraim? Why is that? Manasseh is the eldest. Because remember, Ephraim got the blessing. Manasseh is the eldest of the twins. Where's Ephraim during all this time? And Joseph, seeing and knowing that Judah's anger was stilled, he approached to speak unto Judah in the language of mildness. Oh, he's changing his tune a bit, isn't he? And Joseph said unto Judah, surely you speak truth, and have this day verified your assertions concerning your strength. And may your Elohim, who delighteth in you, increase your welfare. But tell me truly, why from amongst all thy brethren dost thou wrangle with me on account of the lad? And none of them have spoken one word to me concerning him. How come you're doing all the talking, Judah? And Judah answered and said, surely thou must know that I was security for the lad. I was surety for the lad to his father, saying, if I brought him not unto him, I should bear his blame forever. Well, now look what's going to happen. This is what surety is all about. Therefore, I have approached thee from amongst all my brethren. This is why I'm doing the talking. For I saw that thou wast unwilling to suffer him to go from thee. Now, therefore, may I find grace in thy sight, after all these rough words, that thou shalt send him to go with us. And behold, I will remain as a substitute for him. This is what surety is all about. Listen to what he says. To serve thee in whatever manner thou desirest. For wherever thou shalt send me, I will go to serve thee with great energy. Send me to a mighty king who has rebelled against thee. And thou shalt know what I will do unto him and unto his land, although he may have cavalry and infantry or an exceedingly mighty people. I will slay them all and bring the king's head before thee. Dost thou not know? Hast thou not heard? I love that. Hast thou not known? Hast thou not heard? How many times do we hear that? Look at here's something I wanted to read to you. I think this is, have you not known? Have you not heard? The everlasting Elohim, Yehovah, the creator of the ends of the earth, neither faints nor is weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the weak. And to those who have no might, he increases strength. Even the youth shall run and be weary. The young men, the youths, who never run out of energy, they're going to become weary. Now he says the young men shall utterly fall. Those are the strength of the land. The young men utterly fall. But those who wait upon Yehovah shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Oh, that's a promise that I'm intending Yehovah to keep in me. Please, Father, work in your people. Raise us up. Make the weak strong. Yes. Dost thou not know, hast thou not heard, that our father Abraham with his servant Eliezer smote all the kings of Elam with their hosts in one night, 800,000 men? They left none remaining. What is that? 312 men against 800,000. We didn't lose any on our side. They lost that many. And ever since that day, our father's strength that was given unto us for an inheritance, for us and our seed forever. Glory. And Yehovah answered and said, you speak truth. Oh, I was going to say something earlier about that instrument that Benjamin used to find out where Joseph was and to identify Joseph as his brother. Is it possible that that instrument... You know, I talk about supermatter. Supermatter is one of my blogs that I put together. This desk, this computer that we're on, is all perishable. The chair I'm sitting in, it's going to be gone. But there's something in this world that is eternal. And I think it is the men who are born in the spirit the second time. Is it possible that there's something in these men that can help us find them? Is there something? I don't know what it is. But perhaps he had some kind of a device that could detect supermatter. Just a thought. And Joseph answered and said, you speak truth, and falsehood is not in your mouth. For it was also told unto us that the Hebrews have power, and that Yehovah, their Elohim, delighteth much in them. And who then can stand before them? This is Joseph saying this. However, on this condition, I will send your brother. Oh my gosh, Joseph, you're just pushing your luck. If you will bring before me his brother, the son of his mother, of whom you said he has gone down to Egypt, his brother, the son of his mother. And it shall come to pass, when you bring unto me his brother, I will take him in his stead. Oh no! Because not one of you was security for him, to your father. And when he shall come unto me, I will then send with you his brother, for whom you have been security. And Judah's anger was kindled. Here it is again. He's stirring him up against Joseph when he spoke this thing. And his eyes dropped blood with anger. And he said unto his brethren, how does this man this day seek his own destruction and that of all Egypt? And Simeon answered Joseph. Here's Simeon answering Joseph. This is the first time. Did we not tell thee at first that we knew not the particular spot to which he went, and whether he was dead or alive? And wherefore speaketh my Lord like these things? And Joseph observed the countenance of Judah, discerned that his anger began to kindle when he spoke unto him, saying, bring unto me your brother instead, or bring unto me the other brother instead of this brother. And Joseph said to his brethren, surely you said that your brother was either dead or lost. Now if I should call him this day, and he should come before you, would you give him unto me instead of his brother? And Joseph began to speak and to call out, Joseph! Joseph! Come this day before me! Appear to thy brethren and sit before them! Oh, this is, I have to turn to Genesis 45. It's 1:23. Oh, this is a long chapter. I want to finish this chapter. We'll come back to 43 next week, okay? Here it is. And when Joseph spoke these things before them, they looked each to a different way to see from whence Joseph would come before them. And Joseph observed all their acts and said unto them, why do you look here and there? I am Joseph, whom you sold to Egypt. Now therefore, let it not grieve you that you sold me. For as a support during the famine, Elohim sent me before you. Shalak. I was the Shalak of Elohim. Here's what it said. In fact, this is his mother saying it when he was taken. Remember him crying over his mother's grave? Oh, he was so upset. And she said these words. I think it was a vision that he had gotten. Now therefore, my son, it's probably Yehovah speaking to him in a vision. Joseph, my son, hope to Yehovah. Wait for him and do not fear, for Yehovah is with thee. He will deliver thee from all trouble. Rise, my son, go down unto Egypt with thy masters, and do not fear, for Yehovah is with thee, my son. And she continued to speak like unto these words unto Joseph, and he was still. I am Joseph, who you sold into Egypt. Now therefore, let it not grieve you that you sold me. For as a support during the famine did Elohim send me before you. And his brethren were terrified at him when they heard the words of Joseph. And Judah was exceedingly terrified at him. And when Benjamin heard the words of Joseph, he was before them in the inner part of the house. And Benjamin ran unto Joseph, his brother, and embraced him and fell upon his neck. And they wept. Oh, This touches my heart, you know, to have your family be restored. It's such a beautiful thing. And Joseph's brethren saw that Benjamin had fallen upon his brother's neck and wept with him. They also fell upon Joseph and embraced him, and they wept a great weeping with Joseph. They appear to have come to him. In Genesis, it appears that Joseph went to them. I think this is better. And the voice was heard in the house of Joseph that they were Joseph's brethren. And it pleased Pharaoh exceeding, I'll bet it did, for he was afraid of them lest they should destroy Egypt. And Pharaoh sent his servants unto Joseph to congratulate him concerning his brethren who had come to him. And all the captains and the armies of the troop that were in Egypt came and rejoiced with Joseph. And all Egypt rejoiced greatly about Joseph's brethren. I bet you they're terribly relieved that they don't have to fight these guys. And Pharaoh sent his servants to Joseph, saying, tell thy brethren to fetch all belonging to them, and let them come unto me, and I will place them in the best part of the land in Egypt. And they did so. And Joseph commanded him that was set over his house to bring out to his brethren gifts and garments. And he brought out to them many garments, being robes of royalty and many gifts. And Jacob divided them amongst his brethren. Look at what's happening. And he gave unto each of his brethren a change of garments of gold and silver, and 300 pieces of silver. This is what the brothers of Joseph are getting. And Joseph commanded them all to be dressed in these garments and to be brought before Pharaoh. And Pharaoh, seeing all Joseph's brethren were valiant men and of beautiful appearance, he greatly rejoiced. And they afterwards went from the presence of Pharaoh to go to the land of Canaan, to their father, and their brother Benjamin was with them. And Joseph rose up and gave unto them 11 chariots, 11 chariots, one for each brother. And Joseph gave unto them his chariot. That's the 12th chariot upon which he rode on the day he was crowned in Egypt. Why? To fetch his father from Egypt. Oh, isn't that cool? To fetch his father from Egypt. He's sending him his chariot, the chariot of honor. And Joseph sent to all his brothers' seed garments according to their number, and 100 pieces of silver. What did we just say? The father's got 300 pieces of silver. The sons are going to get 100 pieces of silver to each of them. He also sent garments to the women of his brethren, his brother's wives, women, from the garments of the king's women. And he sent them. And he gave unto each of his brethren 10 men. So the 11 sons are all going to get 10 servants to go with them to the land of Canaan to serve them, to serve their seed and all belonging to them in coming to Egypt. And Joseph sent by the hand of his brother Benjamin 10 suits of garments for his 10 sons. Hear that? The other sons got things, but he's going to get things also. He says a portion above the rest of the seed of Jacob's sons. Jacob's seed, the seed of Jacob's seed, the son of Jacob's sons. And he sent to each 50 pieces of silver. So the sons are getting, or his sons, Benjamin's sons, are going to get an additional 50 pieces of silver and 10 chariots on account of Pharaoh. And he sent to his father 10 asses laden with luxuries of Egypt, 10 she-asses laden with corn and bread and nourishment for his father and to all that were with him as provisions for the road. And he sent to his sister Dinah garments of silver and gold, and frankincense and myrrh and aloes and women's ornaments in great plenty. And he sent the same from the women of Pharaoh to the women of Benjamin. So not only his sons are getting extra, so are his women getting extra. Benjamin's women and Benjamin's sons. And he gave all his brethren also to their women, all sorts of onyx stones, bdellium, and from all the valuable things amongst the great people of Egypt. Nothing of all the costly things was left but what Joseph sent to his father's household. And he sent his brethren away, and they went. Man, these guys are going to be rich. And he sent his brothers away, and they went. And he sent his brother Benjamin with them. And Joseph went out with them to accompany them on the road unto the border of Egypt. And he commanded them concerning his father and his household to come to Egypt. And he said unto them, do not quarrel on the road. Listen to this. Do not quarrel on the road. He knows that temptation is to blame one another. Joseph is alive. Do not quarrel on the road, for this thing was from Yehovah to keep a great people from starvation. For there will be yet 5 years of famine in this land. And he commanded them, saying, when you come to the land of Canaan, do not come suddenly before my father in this affair, but act in your wisdom. Don't overtake him with just spilling out the knowledge that Joseph is alive. He's concerned he's going to have a heart attack. Die. Remember, Jacob is 130 years old at this point. I think Jacob lives to be 147, so he's going to be still another 17 years in Egypt. And Joseph ceased to command them, and he turned and went back to Egypt. And Jacob's seed went to the land of Canaan with joy and cheerfulness to their father Jacob. Oh, this is a beautiful story right here. And they came unto the borders of the land. And they said to each other, what shall we do in this matter before our father? For if we come suddenly to him and tell him the matter, he will be greatly alarmed at our words and will not believe us. I think they're more concerned about the death of their father than they not being believed by the father. Look what they're going to do. Remember this little girl, Sarah? She was the daughter of a woman who was taken by another man, son of Shem, son of Eber, but he died. She was left as a widow with a child, 3 or 4 years old, and one of the sons took her. I don't remember which son took her. But this sweet little girl went in the ways of Jacob's seed. Here's what it says. And they went along until they came nigh unto their houses. And they found Sarah, oh, the daughter of Asher, there it is right there, going forth to meet them. And the damsel was very good and subtle. Subtle, I was a little confused by subtle. Characterized by skill or ingenuity. Clever, I think is a good definition. And knew how to play upon the harp. And they called unto her, and she came before them. And she kissed them, and they took her and gave her a harp, saying, go now before our father, and sit before him, and strike upon the harp, and speak these words. Oh, this is so cool how they're going to tell their father that their son, that his son is alive. And they commanded her to go to their house, and she took the harp and hastened before them. And she came and sat near Jacob, and she played well and sang and uttered in sweetness of her words, Joseph, my uncle, is living, and he ruleth throughout the land of Egypt and is not dead. Oh my gosh, I can hardly speak these words myself. Can you imagine Jacob hearing these words? And she continued to repeat and utter these words, and Jacob heard her words, and they were agreeable to him. He listened while she repeated them twice and thrice, and joy entered the heart of Jacob at the sweetness of her words. And the spirit of Elohim was upon him, and he knew all her words were true. Oh, Father, you're so good. And Jacob blessed Sarah when she spoke these words before him. And he said unto her, My daughter, may death never prevail over thee, for thou hast revived my spirit. Only speak yet before me as thou hast spoken, for thou hast gladdened me with all thy words. And she continued to sing these words, and Jacob listened to it, and it pleased him. And she rejoiced, and the spirit of Elohim was upon him. And whilst he was speaking with her, behold, his sons came to him with horses, chariots, royal garments, and servants running before them. And Jacob rose up to meet them and saw his sons dressed in royal garments. And she saw that all the treasures that Joseph had sent to them. And they said unto him, Be informed that our brother Joseph is living, and that he ruleth throughout the land of Egypt. And it is he who spoke unto us as we told thee. Father, do you not know, do you not understand the wisdom of this man? And how, when he speaks to us, the sweetness of his voice. Do you remember what it said? And Jacob heard all the words of his sons, and his heart palpitated, throbbed at their words. For he could not speak until he saw all that Joseph had given them and what he sent them. And Joseph heard all the words of his sons, and his heart palpitated at their words, for he could not believe them until he saw all that Joseph had given them and what he had sent him and all the signs which Joseph had spoken unto them. What are the signs that he had spoken unto them? Do you think it was the prophecy when he was younger that he was talking about? I wonder. And they opened out before him and showed him all that Joseph had sent, and they gave unto each what Joseph had sent them, and he knew that they had spoken truth, and he rejoiced exceedingly on account of his son. And Jacob said, It is enough, it is enough for me that my son Joseph is still living. I will go and see him before I die. He wasn't concerned about the stuff. He says, it's enough that Joseph is still living. And his sons told him all that had befallen them. And boy, that must have been a great story. And Jacob said, I will go down to Egypt to see my son and his offspring. And Jacob rose up and put on the garments which Joseph had sent him. And after he had washed and shaved his hair, he put on upon his head the turban which Joseph had sent him, and all the people of Jacob's house and their women put on the garments which Joseph had sent to them. And they greatly rejoiced at Joseph that he was still living and that he was ruling in Egypt. And all the inhabitants of Canaan heard this thing. Can you imagine? He's been grieving for this son for 22 years. Now he finds out he's alive. All the other people of Canaan have grieved with him. Oh, it's amazing. And all the inhabitants of Canaan heard this thing, and they came and rejoiced much with Jacob that he was, still living. And Jacob made a feast for them for 3 days. Okay, this is a famine. The second year of the famine. Nobody's got food. But Joseph sent so much that now they have food. Jacob made a feast for 3 days. And all the kings of Canaan, the nobles, of the land ate and drank and rejoiced in the house of Jacob. Oh my goodness. Well, we get to see kind of the same thing next week in Genesis 45. We're not going to get to it today. We're going to stop here. But let's look forward. We're going to see what happened. But now that we see what happened in Yasher, when we see what happens next week, we can kind of fill in the gaps. Ooh, that's such a fun thing to do. Hey, thanks for joining me. Please join me again next week as we journey through Torah. Love you tons. Bye now.